All right, time for the glossary of technique, which is all the ways that we can do things in art. And what's our goal when we do them? Well, it's just employing any of these techniques to make some sort of representation of form and light. So let's go about these, and I'm gonna. You can see, I think there's 23 categories. I just folded this paper, sixths like this, and fourths this way. Hey, instant 24 grid. And I'm gonna start down here actually with a wash because I want this to dry first. So a wash is just the idea that, you know, blank white paper is oftentimes not what you want to start with. So what you can do is instead just get this to something that is a little closer in value to all over 70% or so. This is watercolor, but you can also do a wash, metaphorically speaking, just with your pencil, right? If you just went over your whole piece of paper like this, with a blue piece of pencil, eventually that would cover it evenly and lightly enough that you could start at that sort of less than white value. And what is value? Let's go over here. That's the next one we're going to do. Value is just lightness or darkness, and in art, it goes from a scale of pure black to pure white. Now, oftentimes, you want to go with like a percent system, so things like Prismacolor markers are going to say 20%, 20% gray or something. So you could mark these off as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So over here we have 0%. This is 10%. It's going to get a little lighter here. A little lighter there. You can actually sort of show this with pencil really easily. So there you go. 0, 10, 20, 30. Over here, 100%, 90, 80, 70, 60, 50. Now this is important because a lot of times we're going to do things like point to our core shadow or our terminator and try and assess what that value is when we're looking at it. And chances are it's not going to be 0% black anywhere except sometimes on a black material with a black contact shadow. And it's rarely going to be 100% except for reflections, so that's like the last stage. But knowing about that is something we can use to explain it. Let's jump up here actually and talk about some of these other things. Contour is the idea that you can see the way things wrap around. So I'm gonna just stencil in a really quick sphere, perhaps. And imagine it's the Death Star. So there's its center point. And there's like the Death Star trench. So if I have those, that's sort of my guiding light for these contours. I can just constantly follow these contours around my object. And in this way, you know, it looks like the Transformers forming in the old animated movie, which is great, by the way. It's the only good Transformers movie. But this describes form, right? And a lot of times on something like spaceship drawings, is where I do these a ton, you end up putting little rivets in, or divots in, that are basically a contour that go all the way around a ship, and therefore they describe the form with a linear element. Contrast is just lightness versus darkness, so... this is going to be high contrast. It's just something where it's really stark blacks and stark whites. All right. And something like this would be low contrast. So these both are just describing a light area and a dark area, but one is really high contrast and one is really low. That's contrast. Crosshatching is another way that we can show contour, and it's very similar, or it's another way we can show form, and it's very similar to contour. It's basically just the idea that given a form, like a sphere, maybe we'll throw a little Terminator on here. Add in a shadow. The idea is that although we can just fill this in with pure black regular hatching, and that's starting to describe this, we can also cross hatch, which is a way where we go in the opposite direction but maybe still try to show form. So imagine there's like a Death Star here, or a Death Star blaster here, and maybe that's the direction this is coming. And in that way, it's not just a line that makes this darker or lighter, it's specifically a line that makes it wrap around the form. Here's some of these other ones. I'll do a close-up on all of them at the end. So skip to the end. Gradient is very similar to our value scale. It's just a change from light to dark. So I'm using a 4B a lot for this stuff. But if I start a hard edge, I slowly work my way over here. It's just a way that form changes gradually. Graining is one where I think I gotta find something. Graining is the idea that you're using the texture of the paper or the thing that's underneath the paper to end up showing this. So I'll use this because it's got these little ridges. A lot of times it's really handy to work on really thick canvas or something like that. Canvas is like the best example of graining where I might be able to use a canvas. Okay, I'll use. Drawing a blank. What do I have that's within 5 feet? Here, I guess this will work. So see this? It's got this texture here. A lot of times do like rubbings, but really the idea, imagine you had the right kind of paper, graining would be ideal for that, because what you would do is you would use it in such a way that texture shows through. So if you have textured paper, it would be going so light that you're only getting the sort of bumps and ridges of it. So there's your graphite on ridged paper. It would only hit on the topmost area. And so you would see a lot of texture. hard edge is something where, you know, let's use that little spear again. Let's say this is really diffuse lighting, but it's got like a cast shadow. So right here, where this form is touching the shadow, would be a hard edge. There's other edges here, like along this cast shadow, but they're softened. Hatching, same thing as cross hatching, just in one direction. And this is where that elbow idea comes in. You should be moving your arm and not your fingers. Although, if you can just be repetitive with it, you can start seeing the effect. It's really good for hair. Intersection is really important. It's this idea that given any two lines, we want to see this come in a T shape, right? Where this comes right here. These two objects are really understandable as separate because of the way they intersect. And a lot of times my whole mental philosophy of how I'm trying to construct a composition is based around getting good intersections. To show a opposite of that, let's talk about tangents. Tangents are the idea of, oh, here, I'll draw some, like, cubes. So let's say this cube was next to a cube. I could draw that cube with an intersection, or I could draw it separate from here. But what if I drew it like this? Technically, if you have two cubes next to each other, there's some point where they'll have edges touch. And that is really not good in drawing, because in reality you can just move your head around a little and tell from the parallax distortion that they're not touching. But in drawing, we need more evidence that these aren't a bad tangent. So you really want to avoid this idea of tangents, right? Like, let's draw like two circles next to each other. That's a bad tangent. Instead, we want intersections. What's a line? Well, it could be something like this, where it's really, really pretty. Or it could be horrible. It could be what I see students do a lot, which is they want to sort of dancing ants their way into a line. Bad. Lines have quality and emotion and flavor, and all your lines should be something that you try and have them be beautiful and singular. Line weight also matters for this. I can kind of get it with this pencil, I think. Actually, I'll do it with you. So line weight is really important in that. I really love it with these color erase pencils, because you can push down on the tip and sort of get this fall off where it's going from thick to thin, right? Microns are also really good for that. So a lot of times when I'm using a micron, I'll start off really clean and I'll try and go like that. Or if it's got a chisel tip, you can go like that. And all microns actually have a millimeter thickness that tells you how thick or thin they are. So just always think about that. And a lot of times, line weight is something where you build a hierarchy to describe what we care about. Form, where you'll have the outline of a character's face being dark lines, and the minuscule details being really, really small lines. So we totally forgive that you did something like outline somebody's mole, because the line for their chin is much thicker. Line of action and gesture is something that really applies to animation. It's this idea that when we get to figure drawing, You're gonna want a beautiful line to start with. You don't want the dancing ants line. You're gonna want something like, let's draw somebody punching. Like, I could draw a stick figure where I draw his head, I draw his spine, I draw his leg, I draw his other leg. But it's so much better to do something like draw from his fist all the way down to his planted foot. So see, at no point did I do a single, like, chisel-y line. I was always trying to keep this bolt. And this is how you want to start a drawing. You should, in theory, be doing it so light that you can then work up from it. But, you know, a line of action is largely just the first thing that you see. And it should always be pretty. Lost edges are kind of this idea that, let's say we were doing that sphere. It's got a terminator, and it's got a cast shadow. So lost edges is this idea that at different points of this sphere, there's going to be a different value. On the terminator, it's going to be like that. Maybe there's reflected light coming into the form here, and there's reflected light coming into the cast shadow. And down here we have this contact shadow where it's really dark, right? Now, as this transition happens, there's going to be some point here where the value of this shadow is the same as the value of this shadow. And they're sort of unified. And seeking out lost edges just makes for really pretty drawings. It's something that, like, our brain really responds to. There's your last edge. Medium is just the idea that you have different things to work with. You can work in pencil, you can work in colored pencil, you can work in pen, you could work in a marker. You can work in oil paint, you can work in watercolor. Oh, hey, I have watercolor. So, any sort of medium, from toothpaste to expensive oil paints to graffiti or spray paint, can all be used for the same purpose, which is, once you understand the medium, you can represent light and form with it. So don't be beholden to any one medium. Be medium agnostic. Negative space. Let's say you have somebody, I don't know. Let's say you have somebody, I don't know, eating a sandwich. We can describe all this anatomy of how their mouth is open, they got a nose. But instead of seeing this form, what if you try and see the opposite of the form? What if you try and see this inner stuff? That gives you an idea of negative space. And a lot of times, your brain really cartoonifies things. It's like that top of the coffee cup. So when you look at somebody, you're going to draw their eyes big, and their hands big, and their heads big. And as a result, your drawing is going to lose accuracy. But if you can sort of look at the negative space instead, a lot of times you can find really powerful designs that, I don't know, they're also going to be less tied to your thought process, and as a result, you're going to get more accuracy. Outline and silhouette is the idea that I always use Bugs Bunny eating a carrot for this. Yeah. Bugs Bunny is here. And he's got a carrot. That's like my worst Bugs Bunny. He's got his hand over here. Maybe you even have like his teeth. This is why I should have started in pencil. This is something where we can read the silhouette, even if it's terrible. We can tell that this is somebody with a hand on their hip, with a carrot, and bunny ears, right? In theory, this same pose could be somebody with a carrot in front of their face. So there's the stem of the carrot, and they're holding it with their hand, and there's their arm, and here's their torso, and here's their legs, and their feet are both pointing forward, and the bunny ears are touching, right? So what's this? If I fill this in as a silhouette, it's a terrible silhouette. So you should always be trying to make sure that things like your hands are in interesting positions when you draw them. If it reads in silhouette, it's probably a good drawing. Soft edge is sort of the opposite of hard edge. I think the easiest way to do this is that stupid sphere that I draw 100 times a day. There's my sphere. There's my Terminator. Purposefully softening it now. Let's do some cross hatching. We can actually even block in the background. Okay, so given this sphere drawing, we have hard edges and we have soft edges. But the soft edges are still edges, and if you can think about them as edges, you're going to get a much cleaner drawing. Yes, this is a hard edge. Yeah, this is a hard edge. But this is a soft edge. Because it shows sort of the slow, gradual change of a form. A lot of times what you have is the turning of form with a core shadow is soft. Your cast shadow is harder because that object is just sort of cut and pasted on here. But you have light that sort of bleeds into each other, and so it's still got some softness. And then the actual edges of objects are what's really, really hard. So those are hard edges there. Hard, hard. Over here. Stippling is the worst. Don't stipple. I don't know why people stipple, but some people really like it. So let's say we have a quick face. I'm drawing in pencil so I can ink it later. And because I hate stippling, we're going to say that he's bald, so I don't have to stipple too much. Stippling is the idea that, you know, so this is sort of our, core shadow, cast shadow. You do little dots all over. Until it was filled. I had a, you know, I grew up in the the country, and my art teacher in high school had us do lots of stippling assignments, and I recall feeling like so not enjoying it. And later on, I think it was because it would like fill up all the time and keep students from causing trouble. I'm not gonna do that to you. But if you want to, I guess you could stipple. Why would you want to? I don't know. Stumping is another idea in art. It's the idea that I can get gradients in a couple ways. First off, I can just hatch a bunch of stuff in, right? But I can also smear this with my finger, and that kind of moves it around, the fibers. I can use a paper towel, and that'll actually work into the fibers even better. And I can even use a rubber tip thing. A lot of times people use what's called a tortillon. I don't have one handy. But that's another way that you can sort of get really smooth edges. I really like this because you can use it forever. And then you don't see any texture. So if you hate texture, then stumping is for you. I have such a concept art oriented mentality about this stuff. I love a good rendering, but oftentimes what I care about is getting the idea to the point where it's satisfying and then moving on. And so a lot of times I don't have the patience for stumping. I definitely don't have the patience for stippling. Just to talk about stippling a little bit more, I don't want to totally bash it all the time because there are times where it is useful. So I think a good example is if you have a nice big brush, guess what? You can stipple a lot of stuff really, really fast and get texture with that. That's not taking a lot of time. And it's slowly turning this guy into Krusty the Clown. Cool. Alright, thumbnailing is a really important part of the modern design world, which is the idea that you have to ideate. Ideate is a buzzword that means think of ideas. I don't know, I feel bad for saying it. But the idea of thumbnailing is that, let's say you're gonna build a starship, right? And we're gonna look at outlines a lot. These are literally almost about the size of my thumb. Before you spend 20 minutes on a drawing, or even 2 minutes on a drawing, why not spend 30 seconds just getting an interesting idea across? So if I did something like this, imagine these are top-down views of thumbnails, or top-down views of spaceships. It takes me so little effort to make these, and there's no pressure for me to make them good. The idea is to bust out a lot of them really fast. So what if maybe this one has like sort of side compartment? And this one's nice and chunky. One that's like a circle. Is it symmetrical? Is it, I don't know. Is it fast? Is it a transport? Who knows what kind of spaceship I'm making? But I have a lot of ideas out really, really fast. I gotta get away from my comfort zone, which is I really like H-shaped ships, I think. Let's make an M-shaped ship. Let's make an asymmetrical one. And you know, I kind of like this one, kind of like this one, the last one I did. So now I could go in and commit to, say, this one. And you know, I got something that's a lot more fun, I think, than if I had just started drawing without thumbnailing first. So thumbnailing is great for creative processes, and especially when you're doing things like drawing really boring basic shapes and forms. There's so many ways that you can put these dumb Legos together to make an interesting idea. I'll stop drawing on the spaceship. It's so fun. Texture's the last one, and I think like some of the stuff that I did with the brush here is an example of that. Texture is just the idea that your medium might have texture, your paper might have texture, and that's where like graining comes in. You know, something like a dying Sharpie can have texture, or a dying pen can have texture. I think like this micron is dying. Like, yeah, see how that micron is almost so dead that it's got a lot of weight, or it's got a lot of flavor going on. This brush, this watercolor brush, has an exact load where there's not too much water in it, just enough to make the pigment interesting. So now that I draw this, I can get something that's gonna make, you know, if I was doing like a tree branch or something, I can have this have a lot of texture, and like something like fur or hair or, you know, rock faces and stuff, a lot of times they sort of blend together in our mind, and if you can represent the idea of the texture behind that, that's the only way you can do it on like a piece of watercolor paper this big, right? So yeah. This is the Glossary of Techniques, and hopefully you can use this to inform what you might want to use for techniques on your glossary of form.